Hello, welcome you all for the next video on a log rank test. Here we will be comparing two survival curves. We will be using a log rank test for comparing the statistical significance between two curves, that is survival curve 1 and survival curve 2. Whether there is any significant difference between the two, you would like to test it. Now to test for that, we'll be using a non-parametric test called as log rank test, and which is the most widely used test for this purpose. Remember one thing, it can test only the statistical significance, that is whether there exists any significant difference between the two curves or not. It can identify, but it cannot give you the quantitative difference between the two groups. So how big is the difference, you won't be able to know. Now let's understand the concept before we use the method. First, you will have to know what is hazard function. It's instantaneous probability of having an event at a time per unit time, given that one has survived or has not had an event. So let us put up this way, event happened or event doesn't happen up to that particular time t. So hazard function is associated with each curve at each time interval. So you just have to remember our Kaplan-Meier analysis, what we had done in the previous video lecture. There we had different time intervals at which the event occurs, or it may be censored. Here we are interested only in the event, not censoring. So if the event occurs, hazard function is present at that particular time instant of time, and it is true for all the survival curves. Now we come across one more term called as hazard ratio, HR. Now it measures the relative survival experience in the two groups. Now let me say that there are two groups. Each has got hazard function at an instant. So at that particular instant, compare the two hazard functions, and the ratio between those two is called as hazard ratio. So hazard function of A, group A, hazard function of group B, compared at the same time interval, the ratio between the two is called as HR, hazard ratio. And we equate it to an equation, exponential of beta. Now this forms our null hypothesis. What does the null hypothesis say for this particular case, that is log rank test? Over the period of time, h of t can vary, that is hazard function can vary between the two curves, whereas hazard ratio remains the same, that is under null hypothesis. Hazard ratio remains same. If hazard ratio should remain same throughout the time interval, that exponential beta, which we had equated to HR, should be equal to 1. The meaning exponential beta is equal to 1, it means HR is equal to 1. If HR, hazard ratio, is equal to 1, what does that mean? Hazard function of curve A, hazard function of curve B are equal. So there exists no difference between the two hazard survival curves. So exponential beta is equal to 1, or you can write it as beta is equal to 0. If beta is equal to 0, exponential of beta will be equal to 1. This forms the basis of our null hypothesis. So going in the reverse way, if beta is equal to 0, we prove that beta is equal to 0 significantly, exponential beta will be equal to 1, which means hazard ratio is equal to 1, whereas hazard ratio is the ratio between hazard function of two curves. If HR is equal to 1, hazard function of two curves will be same, which means there is no difference in hazards between the two curves, or in simple, there is no statistical significant difference between the two survival curves. That forms the null hypothesis. Alternative hypothesis, you can go for two-tailed hypothesis, or you can go for one-tailed hypothesis. When you say two-tailed hypothesis, it is beta not equal to zero. If you want to look at the one-tailed hypothesis, you can break down that not equal as either greater than zero or lesser than zero. For greater than 0, it means exponential of beta is a higher value, a number more than 1. That means group A participants are consistently at a greater chance of attaining the event. Means for curve A, the attaining the event are earlier than group B. So when beta is less than 0, negative, that means exponential factor is HR, that is hazard ratio is less than 1. In that case, this particular condition reverses. So let us look at the test method. How do we perform the test? First, we'll consider the null hypothesis beta equal to 0, and we want to test it against the alternate hypothesis beta not equal to 0. That means I'm considering two-tailed test here. So what we have to do is we have to subdivide the time interval, whole time interval, as per our data that is available to us for the Kaplan-Meier estimate. We'll divide it to k number of small time intervals. How do we do it? We'll look into the illustration how we do it. So we'll divide into k number of time intervals. So in our hand, k set of time intervals are available. Now for each k, at each k time interval, we'll have to convert the whole data set into 2 into 2 contingency table, which looks like this. How do we get this? This is for the curve A, exponential variable for A, that is a group A, and another for group B, maybe control or reference you can take. There are two curves, survival curves we will be considering. So curve A versus curve B. At that particular time interval, which you have considered K, at this particular time interval, how many events have occurred for group A, for group B, we'll be writing here. The remaining for which the event has not occurred, that means they are surviving at the end of that time, till that end of the time. So you'll be writing it here for two curves. So this is event occurred, this is event not occurred. Event occurred for group B, event not occurred for B. That is A, B, C, D. I refers to the time interval. Now this capital A is the marginal sum, A plus B. Capital C is the marginal sum of group B, C plus D. X is the column sum, that is total event that has taken place, A plus C. This is called as column sum. This is called as column sum for event not occurred, X and Y. So X, Y, A and C are the marginal sums. A, C is the row sum, X and Y are the column sum. They are called as marginal sums. The total of that is A plus C equal to N, or X plus Y is equal to N. This is the total number of event that has occurred, or total that we have considered, that you can simply write this way: A plus B plus C plus D will be equal to N. Next step is to calculate the test statistic chi-square. So this particular method follows a chi-square distribution. You'll have to calculate the observed frequencies. Observed frequency, we are concentrating on this particular cell 1 1. Keep that in mind before you apply the formula. We are concentrating on this particular cell number 1 1, first cell, first row, first column. So that is for the group A, event occurred. This particular is our pivotal point. Keep that in mind. With respect to this, we do all the calculation. So observed frequencies in cell number 1 1, how much is there? So this, remember, this sigma is for all the k time intervals. So within sigma, whatever you calculate, this, that term is for a particular table. So AI is the value, OI is equal to AI. So the term O, this value equation, you'll be getting AI. This, only this value you'll have to note down. Next, E, expectation value, expected value EI, let me say it as EI. Expected value EI is nothing but any cell you consider, its marginal sum product, that is product of the row sum and column sum, X into A divided by total sum N. You can see it here, A into X divided by N, A into X, that is, they are the marginal sum for this particular cell AI. For this cell, marginal sums are AI and XI. Take a product of that divided by total sum NI. That is called as expected value of a given cell EI. Then you have to calculate the variance for that particular table. For that particular table, variance, how do you calculate? Multiply or take the product of all marginal sums AI into CI multiplied by XI multiplied by YI. This forms the numerator, divided by total number square into N minus 1. This is N square minus N minus 1. Remember, this table changes from each K. As time interval changes, this table, all the values may change. There is a high probability that that will change. Now you calculate the chi-square. Chi-square for overall, this is the overall value. You have to consider all k terms for calculating this. Whereas within sigma term, whatever terms are there, it is for each table. So for each, for all the tables, all k tables, sum it up, that becomes O. Similarly, sum of all EIs, you get E. Sum of all variances, you get V. Now you consider the summed up values. Observed value minus expected value, square it, divided by variance, that is the chi-square. If you remember one sample t-test, what did we do there? Do that, we got z value, or you can write it as z square there. We used the t distribution, right? Or z distribution you have used. There, z square is equal to x bar minus mu square divided by sample variance, that is S, that you have considered. It is very similar to that. For a two-sided test, what we have to identify is, first you have to calculate the significance level alpha, which is nothing but the reverse of confidence interval. Say confidence interval is 95%, alpha is equal to 0.05. So based on the confidence interval, you will select the value of alpha. If I want 95% usual case, 95% confidence interval, then alpha will be equal to 0.05. For this 0.05, for degrees of freedom 1, alpha is equal to 0.05, degrees of freedom 1, find out from the chi-square table the value of critical value. The critical chi-square value you can find out. For 95% confidence interval, alpha is equal to 0.05, and degrees of freedom 1, usually this chi-square value is 3.84 from the table. Now compare this with respect to the calculated chi-square value. So if the calculated value is greater than the critical value, you need to reject the H0. So this is the step which gives you whether you have to accept or reject the H0 based on which is the common usual condition. Now why the degrees of freedom 1 is that? The degrees of freedom of for chi-square, how do you calculate? Number of rows minus 1 multiplied by number of columns multiply the two terms, number of rows minus 1, number of columns minus 1. Here number of rows is 2 number of rows are there, 2 minus 1, 1. Number of columns, 2 are there, 2 minus 1, 1. So it is 1 into 1, 1. So the degrees of freedom is nothing but R minus 1 into C minus 1. R is row, C is column. So let me repeat, how did we get 1 degrees of freedom for chi-square test from the critical table? Degrees of freedom will be equal to R minus 1 into C minus 1, that is row minus 1 into column minus 1, number of rows, number of columns. So let me give you an illustration how we use this particular method. I am using the same data from my previous video lecture on Kaplan-Meier estimates or Kaplan-Meier survival curve. There I had used this particular data for group A and B. You observe that there is no censoring of data. If the censoring is of the data is there, remember you are not going to consider as the event, but you will be considering it for the total. Remember that when the time comes in the further slides, I will get you to that particular point. This is the Kaplan-Meier curve we had got in the previous problem or the video lecture there, and we had found the median for two curves and found that at 2 and 4. The two medians were at 2 and 4. So there is a difference. 2 and 4 are different values, right? Whether they are statistically significant, we do not know. Whether these two curves are statistically significant, we are unable to tell. For that, we are using this log rank test. Now, what we have to do is stepwise. First, let us define the null hypothesis. There exists no difference in survival curve for two groups. Alternative, there is a significant difference. Let us consider alpha is equal to 0.05. Next task is to divide the time span into k subgroups. What we will do is this. Consider the event in ascending time order, both A and B. That means I am pooling the data. Group A and B, I am pooling the data. While pooling, I will have to ensure that I am considering the Ti only for that time where the event occurs. If there is a censoring, I will have to reject that. I don't have to consider the censored time interval. I will have to consider only the event time, and I have to pool it and put it in ascending order. So if you observe this, and this particular series, it is in the ascending order, 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3, 3.4, 4.5. So the time interval, these are the time intervals. So the total number of time interval is 8. So k will be 1 to 8. Start from 1, it ends up to 8. So there are 8 time intervals we will have to consider. Right. What we have to do next? We will have to compute the 2 into 2 contingency table for 8 intervals. Like this way. So ith k, if you take it, that is at the time ti, any value. Ti takes any value here. Group A and B will have to write. Events that has occurred at ti, events, which are surviving, the remaining are surviving, we'll have to consider for group B, A and B individually. So the plus means number for which event occurred, minus means number for which event not occurred. So you will have to write the frequencies in this cell. Then we'll have to calculate OI, EI and VI for this particular table based on this formula which you already discussed. Let's look at this for a particular case. Let me consider this k is equal to 1. At k is equal to 1, the first time interval, that is 1, time is equal to 1. Let me consider this value. At time is equal to 1, for group A, there exists one event and all others are surviving beyond that. That means at time is equal to 1, one event has occurred. For group A, one event has occurred. How many survive? 4 are surviving. So total at risk is 5. So there were 5 at risk, of which one the event has occurred. Now let us look at group B at the same time interval. That is at time t is equal to 1. Remember, it starts from 2.5 here, then it goes on increasing. So 5 are at risk at t is equal to 1. 5 are at risk. You can see here 5 are at risk, but there is no event at t is equal to 1. At event time t is equal to 1, all are surviving. There is no event occurring. So the number of event is 0. Let me repeat, for group A, there are 5 at risk at t is equal to 1, of which for one frequency, the event occurs, plus for remaining, it survives. That is, out of 5, one event takes place, 4 survives, out of 5, 0 event, 5 survives. Now, let's take the marginal sum, 1 plus 0, 1, 4 plus 5, 9, column sums, row sum, group A, 1 plus 4, 5, 0 plus 5, 5, total 10. Now what you have to do is you will have to calculate the OEV. So how did we calculate using the formula OEV? So you have a formula here. So we'll calculate that way. So that is AI, this value 1, OI is equal to 1, EI marginal sums 5 into 1 divided by 10. 5 row sum multiplied by the column sum. Remember, we are taking this particular one, cell number 11 as the pivotal point. With respect to this, I have done the calculation. So it is 5 into 1 divided by 10, that is EI is equal to 0.5. Then variance, multiply all the marginal sums, 5 into 5 multiplied by 1 into 9 divided by n square into n minus 1, that is 100 minus 100 into 9. So you get 0.25. Right. You can pause the video here, take a second and fill up the box yourself. Alright, let me assume that you have paused the video and you have filled up the box. Let us check whether you are right or wrong. Now, in this case, the k is equal to 2. Second table, t is equal to 1.5. That is, t is equal to 1.5. I have just moved to the next k, 1.5. So, let us see whether you are right. At 1.5, what has happened? How many are at risk? One, for the first one, event is already occurred. It has left the study. Remember, you'll have to cancel it, cross it out now. At when you come to k is equal to 2. Here, 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 are at risk. Out of that, one event has occurred and the 3 event does not occur. Whereas group B at 1.5, still the event has not occurred. At 2.5 event occurs, but 1.5 event has not occurred. So 5 are at risk and of that, 5 are surviving. There is no risk event for the anyone of that. So the row sum, 1 plus 3, 4, 0 plus 5, 5, column sum, 1 plus 1, 1 plus 0, 1, 3 plus 5, 8, 4 plus 5, 9, total n is equal to 9. Similar to this, you will have to calculate. Now, remaining two, you can pause the video and try yourself. Alright. Now here you have to move to the next k values, k is equal to 3, that is a 2. At a t is equal to 2, you will have to look for group A, you will have to look for group B. At a 2, if you see that there are 3 are at risk and all 5 are at risk. Whereas for the next table, 2.5, there are 2 are at risk and there are 5 are at risk. You will have to identify which where the event is taking place. Now, the point that I was telling you, well, if there is censoring, say for example there is a censoring at a 2 here, at a 2 if there is a censoring, how you have to account for it? If there is a censoring, you will be counting that for at risk condition. Remember, it is surviving till the end, there is no event occurring, so at t is equal to 2, if there is, I'm saying if there is plus here, that is if it is censored, you'll be considering it under a risk, but you will not be considering it under event, because at t is equal to 2, time is equal to 2, event has not occurred for it, it is surviving. Remember that it is surviving. Now event doesn't occur for that, it survives and it is at risk. At t is equal to 2, it has left the study. That means you will not consider that censored value in the next set. So that means when you come to the 2.5, the at risk will be only 2, you will not be considering. So the censored value will be under no event here, but it will be considered at risk and no event here, and it will be excluded for the next table. So you need to take care about censored values in this way. So filling up the table, have all the 8 tables filled up here. You can pause the video and you can just calculate yourself and compare the results with your calculations. Let me go ahead otherwise. Now what I have done is, for 8 tables, the calculated values OEV, observed value, expected value and variance, for each table I have listed here. Next step is to calculate the test statistic. What we have to do, we'll have to sum up the observed values, we have to sum up the expected values, we have to sum up the variances. That is, observed value, you'll have to sum it up, 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1, like this, 1 plus 1, 0, 0, 0. So totally there are 5 O's. Then expected values, how many are there? 0.5, 0.44, 0.375, 0.571, 0.0, 0.2, and remaining zeros, you'll have to sum it up, you get 2.091. I take 3 decimal approximation or accuracy, you can take up to 2 decimal also. Then variance, similarly, you sum it up, it comes to 1.231. Now calculate the chi-square, our test statistic, observed minus expected square divided by variance, it comes to 6.87. There is one clue, you can see that there are certain zeros. So you'll have to identify when the zeros come into picture. So if that is very clear to you, the calculation becomes a little simpler. Try it yourself, you'll understand. Then outcome, how do we analyze the outcome? For a two-sided test, significance level alpha, that is 0.05, we have taken. For that, chi-square is 3.84. Now compare the 3.4, again it's a calculated test statistic, 6.87. You find that calculated value is more than the tabled value or critical value. So hence our rule book says reject the H naught. What is the meaning of reject the H naught? Null hypothesis is not considered. You are going to consider the alternative hypothesis, which means there exists significant difference in between the two survival curves. Here the case was for the efficacy of two drugs, the survival curve was for the two curves. So there exists significant difference in the efficacy of two drugs or between the two survival curves. So that's the outcome of log rank test. So it tells you whether there exists a significant difference between the two or not. It doesn't tell how much is the difference, that you have to use other estimates. Now this is one method. I have one alternative approach. Same method, instead of writing in tables, we can write it in a different way. Same method, same formula, same thing, but it is in a single tabled format if you want to do manually or if you want to use an Excel sheet. If you want to use an Excel sheet or doing it manually, this kind of calculation will be easier for you. But you may have to include one more table if you want to consider the censored value. This is for uncensored values. There is no censoring for this. This is applicable. If there is censoring, you will have to include one more for censoring effects. Now, what I have done here, at time interval t is equal to 1, first time interval we have taken, we have drawn the contingency table. If you remember, this was for the row 1, 1 at risk, 4 event doesn't occur, and 5 at risk, 1 event occurs and 4 event doesn't occur. This was in the first row, and for group B, this was in the second row, 5 at risk, 0 event, 5 no event. So this is in the second row, this was in the first row. So the second row comes here. I have written in a single line. That is A, B, C, D. Sorry, C and D. The marginal sums. That is the row sum is 5. Row sum is 5 here. Ci and Ai. Column sums are written next. That is Xi and Yi. Event total total survived, that is a plus ci. This is ci plus ai, that is column sum, right? That is xi here. Then bi 4, di 5, the column sum will be equal to yi 9. So total is 10. Now you calculate the remaining things, oi, vei and vi, observed, expected and variance for each cells you calculate. Next, what you have to do, you have to run through the entire table, that is all the time intervals you have to write one below the other. So there are 8 values that are written. So for each table you will calculate O, E and V, then you will calculate the sum of it. I was telling you something about you will get 0, you find out, right? Now here is the trick. If you observe it carefully, AI, AI and marginal sum, and marginal sum over here, right? If this AI, that is a marginal sum, if this is 0, right? If this marginal sum AI is 0, the whole value goes 0. Because marginal sum, it has come from AI. If this AI is 0, automatically this AI is also 0, right? Because if there is no subject at risk, obviously there is no event. So both will be 0. If these two are 0, your all values are 0. You don't have to do any calculation. Automatically it becomes 0. You can see here, AI is 0. There is a product term including 0, A. There is a product term including A. So automatically it becomes 0. So when you do a manual calculation for examination purpose, this comes handy. Just observe for at risk for that first row, group A. If this is 0, automatically all these values become 0. You don't have to waste your time in doing the calculation. Yes, that's the end of this video lecture. Thank you.